Hey everybody, today I am going to be reviewing Roma. This film was written and directed by Alfonso Cuarón. Cuarón is definitely one of the most famous Hispanic directors out there, and even though he hasn't made a lot of films, his films have reached just such a wide variety of audiences internationally. From the more independent, more intimate pieces like Y tu mamá también, which received a lot of critical acclaim, to films like A Little Princess, which was a movie that when I was a little girl, just absolutely adored. And of course, the huge blockbuster films that he's made. He made the third film in the Harry Potter series, Prisoner of Azkaban, which I think we can all agree is by far the best one. And then more kind of dystopian political films such as Children of Men. And then his last film was Gravity, which was maybe the most successful film that he had made to date. I admire all of those films for different reasons, but with this film, Roma, he is going back to his roots and doing something that is a lot more stripped down and more intimate piece, a lot like Y tu mamá también. It's loosely based on his childhood experiences being raised by the women in his life, his mother as well as his maid. In this film, the stand-ins for that would be the mother, Theresa, and Cleo, who is one of the household maids. Cleo is nearly taciturn in the film, and I think that Cuarón is definitely relying a lot on the black and white cinematography. As Orson Welles always said, black and white is a lack of distraction. There's no color, no, you know, like blue eyes or blonde hair to distract from you. And with the black and white, you really get to see all of her vulnerability and a lot of her expression in her eyes. But when she speaks, I mean, she barely speaks throughout the movie, but when she does, she speaks very softly, you know, almost where you can't hear her. There's a strength in the midst of that where the actual events of the story themselves carry her forward rather than her really propelling the story forward. And in a huge way, that really represents kind of who she is and what she stands for in the actual house, because yes, she does a lot for this family, probably a lot more than they give her credit for, and she takes care of the children and they love her. I don't think that's part of her paycheck, and yet she's never quite in the family. There's always that divide. She is one of the servants, you know, one of the maids. So even though she does feel like part of the family, she's always going to be in the background, always distant from them. Teresa, I think, is a very strong character in contrast to Cleo in terms of just her personality. She is somebody that is very frustrated in her life because her marriage is falling apart, and her husband is basically leaving her with all of these children so he can go have an affair with another woman. And so understandably, she feels abandoned, as though she has no emotional support and no financial support. And I think that this causes her to lash out a lot at Cleo, of course, and a lot at her children as well, but she knows that it's not right. She's just somebody who makes mistakes and is somebody that's going through a tough time. She's not a bad person. She's also very caring, and you can see that she really does love her children. And I think that she empathizes a lot with Cleo, especially when Cleo comes to her and says that she's pregnant by her boyfriend who abandoned her when he found out the news. And of course, I think that this really resonates with Teresa because she's going through something very similar when her husband abandons her. So she feels the need to care for Cleo and support her throughout the pregnancy. In the film, Cuarón likes to use a lot of very long takes, which is definitely a staple of his. A lot of his shots in this movie just pan back and forth and back and forth slowly. It's meticulously choreographed, and there is a slight distance to it, a kind of a break between the audience and these shots. It makes the worlds themselves and the frame feel very flattened. And I kind of like that because it makes us feel like we are experiencing a different time, that we're not right in the middle of everything. And we're looking at this nostalgia through somewhat of a filter. But when we meet the father, you see a major contrast between the way he is shot and the way everybody else is shot, because rather than getting that distant framing where his character slowly becomes visible in the foreground of the film, we see the shots are broken up. As soon as he's pulling his car into the driveway, we see his hand, we see the car light, the side mirrors. I don't think you need to be some cinephile that knows a lot about movies to know that as soon as you see the way those shots are broken up, this is a person that is going to remain an enigma to us. We're never going to see him fully, and he is not going to be integral in terms of the emotional arc of the film. Like I said, the movie is shot in black and white, 65 millimeter, and it does remind me a lot of Children of Men, a lot of the choreographed shots in that in particular, and as well as Y tu mamá también, kind of the kind of mundane quality of it. And as I said, there's a feeling of distance, and many of the shots, as I said, are long shots, and yet the prolonged nature of the shots allows kind of the nuance to slowly enter the frame slowly. We must look at what's happening on screen and each little vignette that's happening throughout the movie and decide what it means for us. The sound design is also really important in this movie. It is diegetic. You're hearing a lot of overlapping sounds, car radios and cars honking, as well as all this overlapping dialogue, to the point where it sounds like gibberish a lot of the time. Like, you don't know who's speaking or what's going on. But in the same way that you're watching it visually, you're picking out little pieces here and there, and you don't necessarily have to catch all of it. You're just picking the pieces that stand out to you, and then you're sort of building some sort of emotional crux that is tying the scene together. Nostalgia in the film and the way that that is handled is very interesting, because Cuarón is definitely using a lot of influence from other film movements, such as, major one is Italian neorealism. That is glaring. The similarities, of course, using unknown actors or untrained actors, often telling a very simple but effective story, usually about impoverished working class people. And honestly, this movie reminded me a lot of some early Fellini works, which is understandable because a lot of those movies came out at the same time as that Italian neorealist movement was happening, and so there was a lot of influence in his early work before he got more experimental. But in particular, the moment where the guy has the blindfold and he's standing on one foot, that reminded me a lot of something I might have seen out of La Strada or Knights of Cabiria. All of that adds to the texture of the world and trying to recreate the nostalgia of a different time, and they do it so impeccably. And with the black and white, there's a timelessness, there's a classic quality to that style where it feels like it could almost take place in any time. That's why what I love so much about black and white is just that classic timeless simplicity to it, where in this movie the smaller moments seem to have a lot more to say than the larger events, at least in my view. This film, like Y tu mamá también, is also a coming of age story, but in that film, Y tu mamá también, you know, it's taking place amidst the backdrop of a lot of political and social upheaval, just like this one. And I think that those events are reflected in the conflict of the characters as they are going through this world transition in their lives. But for me, and look, I haven't seen Y tu mamá también in a while, it's been maybe a couple years, but it feels more like in that film the character dynamics serve the political chaos rather than being kind of passive in the midst of it like in Roma. I actually wish that the emotional story, the core story, could have been more integral in terms of weaving in the social commentary, because there are a lot of things that are touched on in the movie, but they're not really explored in any sort of complex sense. A big symbol, of course, is class divide, and I would have liked to see more of that reflected between the Cleo character and the Teresa character, because I do think they have a very fascinating relationship, perhaps the most fascinating one in the entire movie. It's because they are going through a lot of the same things, but yet their situations are so different. Because, you know, Cleo, you know, what does she have? She has nothing. She has no one to go to. This is her only family, really. And she doesn't have money to take care of this child. Whereas Teresa, you know, she's got an education and she can get a job, she can take care of her children. Having one person being upper class and the other one not, and there's always that divide, I think that there's a lot you can open up in terms of a conflict that could have been delved into. How do Cleo's experiences and her emotional arc tie in with the events of the story is one that I also wish could have been handled a little bit better. I mean, she is the main character, and yet we know so little of her. She is passive in the events rather than being the initiator, which is fine to an extent. But at the same time, I think that the story could have had more weight and more pathos had her story and her kind of emotional struggles reflected more of what's happening. In particular, there's one scene that is very reminiscent of Children of Men. In that film, Children of Men, there is this strong female symbol of maternity in Ki, who of course is having a baby. She's about to give birth in the middle of a war, essentially, and it happens at the worst time. Her water breaks. It's a big moment. And this film reminds me of it because in this one, Cleo is buying furniture right in the middle of the a staged version of the 1971 Corpus Christi massacre. And it is extraordinarily shot. And how they did that, I don't know. It was pretty amazing to watch. And of course, in that moment, her water breaks. But there's something about this scene that feels a little bit disjointed and perplexing, as incredible as it is to watch out of context, mainly because there's very little explanation there. And I don't think it feels particularly right to frame the pregnancy within this event, because the ideas, again, are not really that fleshed out. They just feel a little simplistic. It's barely sketched over, and that kind of cheapened the effect of it for me. And part of that, of course, is the intention of the story, I think. I think that I see these characters and all of these events as just kind of pieces of a larger whatever, a larger symbol, a larger tapestry of elements. And yet I still think that there is a lot of exploring that they could have done in terms of the social and political barriers. You can infuse that into the character conflicts that opens up the story in more interesting ways. And you can do that without being too overt. It's a difficult thing to do, but I think that Cuarón is totally capable. Maybe if I see this movie again, I might have a different point of view on that. I see this movie as one that where I might see it multiple times and this style of it might grow on me a little bit more, but I don't know. It's hard to say after only seeing it once. But overall, I did find the film to be very impressive technically, very impressive aesthetically, and even having a strong emotional core that really does resonate. However, like a lot of Cuarón films, even though I admire all of them for different reasons, there is something about them that I feel lacks in complexity, that is a little bit too simplistic, and I wish he could have always delved into the ideas more. I feel this pretty much about most of his films, especially ones like Children of Men. But this film is a very good one, and one of his best films by far. I think that this is probably his best film since Y Tu Mamá También, which is probably my favorite of all of his films that I've seen. So definitely check this film out if you haven't, especially if you were a fan of classic filmmaking, especially like Italian neorealism. This is a really beautiful piece of work, and I think a lot of people are going to find something at least to admire in it. And that is my review. Thank you all for watching. If you'd like to follow me on social media, the links for that are below. You can watch more videos here, and you can subscribe if you'd like. Catch you next time.